Greetings and welcome everyone to, I don't know what we call this, like an Angry Chicken special report. I'm Garrett. I'm here as always, my Hearthstone partner in crime, Jocelyn. Hey, Joss.
Hi, guys.
And we're here for a very special reason today. That's because an armadillo monster has been revealed in Hearthstone. And we have Mike, Donais, and Dave Kosak from the Hearthstone team here to talk to us about what appears to me from the art, if, you know, things are to scale. I know goblins are small, but they're not this small. It appears to be a really big armadillo with rockets and a laser strapped to its back.
Are we ready? Are we ready to do this? Because we are.
Oh, my gosh. We're not ready. Oh,
we are happening? Prepared.
Oh, the hats.
Over top of the headphones.
Let us discuss.
It's perfectly.
Armagedillo.
Do you have a couple of ferns you can bring in the frame?
Strap up the nose.
How did he get so big, Dave? How did that?
The armadillo. Yeah, you know what? Something we've been talking about all year, the Year of the Dragon, is the League of Evil gets together, what are they going to do? Like, how are they going to help each other out? And so it's kind of like combined tactics, right? So clearly, Dr. Boom built an armature of rockets. And he's like, this is ready to go. And they're like, well, all we got is an armadillo. And it's like this big. What are we going to do? So Hagatha comes in, does her crazy, giant armadillo, put some rockets on that thing. Now we're ready to go. This is how the League of Evil is working together.
That's an awesome backstory for a giant armadillo tank.
yeah, that was made up moments ago. And we're very happy with it.
It's a true story.
But our team just gets together and they just brainstorm, like, what would be crazy? What would they do? What would they do in the desert? And this is the kind of thing that they come up with that is just phenomenal. It's so much fun.
That's rad. Yeah, it's quite the backstory. So this card, I just look at it as a campaign for a taunt boomship deck. Was that the main goal with this? You're just trying to get boomship out into some more ladder decks?
There definitely is a taunt deck. The taunt synergies are going to be there. You're going to see a lot of them with the new expansion. And this is the legendary in the set, so it fits in perfectly. The boomship, I don't know. Boomship really... really need some really large minions that are like large.
So wait, giant armadillo who is also covered in rockets and lasers is not big enough for the boom ship.
He is big.
He's getting there.
But the thing is, he works with like, you want to have like a handful of taunt minions. And if you put them all into play with boom ship, then he's not going to get that synergy because he'll activate and he'll miss. I do like when people go back to cards like Boomship and start like looking, what are the big minions I can get out with it? Stuff like that.
Outside of cards we maybe can't talk about yet, are there any cards that are, you know, already in the game that you're pulling off fun combos with over at Blizzard HQ with our armadillo friend here?
There is a bunch of new ones, but the best one that is already out there that I've seen is Ziliax. I had an 11 attack, basically like an 11-10 Ziliax in my hand because of this card and some other cards that work with it that are in the set. There's a lot. One of the things that we like about the idea of a taunt deck is you're putting lots of minions in play and you're attacking your opponent. So not only do you have a lot of defense, which warriors need, but you also end up with your victory condition sort of built into it, you know, hitting your opponent with face damage. And in particular, buffing taunt minions is really good because once you've buffed them, you put them into play and they're already buffed. They have to kill them. They can't just ignore them. Like normally, if you put a 10-10 into play, people just go face and kill you. So I think it has a lot of good synergy. I think it'll see some play and it'll be pretty fun, especially with Ziliax and the new taunts, both in warrior and in neutral.
Yeah, that'll free up, like Ziliax specifically too. I mean, that's going to free up a little bit of armor generation off of the lifesteal.
Yeah, absolutely.
So is hand buffing something that you guys as a team were looking at kind of bringing back into Warrior since Mean Streets of Gadgetzan? We haven't really seen a whole lot of it. So is this something that you're really kind of pushing with this expansion?
Yeah, fun mechanics that people like, we're going to bring back and we're going to do them different ways each time. So it'll be a little bit different. Now it's taunt hand buffing specifically, but in general, we'll bring them back. It's kind of part of the identity of Warrior now. And when we feel it's right, maybe next time it'll be slightly different implementation again. But I'm looking forward to the deck. I like warrior decks that have a little bit more sort of victory conditions to them. The warrior decks that go to like turn 40 or whatever, they kind of tire people out a little bit.
Gotcha. Okay. I like the sound of that a lot. Have you been listening to recent episodes with things I've been griping about? It sounds like.
Maybe. Yeah.
So I want to talk about tribes for just a second, because I have to know, you know, looking at the, just again, going back to the art for Armagedillo, you know, how many mechanical additions have to be slapped on a beast for it to go from a beast to a mech?
Yeah, the basic idea is, what are people's first read when they see a card? When they glance at it, do they think, oh yeah, at first glance, they immediately think beast, or do they immediately think mech? And that's kind of what we go for. Sometimes it's not super obvious, so I'm sure people can find counterexamples. Yeah. But in general, that's our goal when we choose minion types.
Is it a little tiny driver inside a big mech and you just see a giant machine? Or, right. Or is it like literally, in this case, a giant Armagedillo that just happens to have some big rockets?
was the idea of making this card a mech anything to do potentially with Warriors having too much mech synergy stuff going on right now? Like, would that just be one step too far for balance?
It seems like a good idea. In this case, people, like the team just kind of brainstormed a bunch of stuff. What would you see in the desert? You'd probably see a camel, you'd probably see an armadillo, probably see a bunch of other stuff. So this one kind of happened naturally, but we do think a lot about that stuff and probably will make sure that we're careful with like the power level of the mechs that come out in each expansion and how they synergize and sort of play test that.
You also did mention returning to some mechanics that people enjoyed from previous expansions. So, I mean, this to me, obviously, we already mentioned hand buffing from Mean Streets of Gadgetzan, but then obviously taunt with Ungoro and the quest. So are we going to see any kind of maybe like tri-class hand buffing stuff or maybe taunt quests? I don't know if you can actually answer that kind of stuff, but like more mechanics in the lines of things we've seen from Warrior in the past?
Yes. We try to have like two different themes in each class, at least, so you can, if you don't like one, you can try the other one out. So like, if there's a quest, the quest will be different than the other, you know, maybe the two legendaries in the set push into different directions. So if you have one, you go one way, and if you have the other one, you go the other way. That's an example that we might do.
We're revisiting quests this time around. And although mechanically they work the same, they kind of fill a really kind of different gameplay niche, because they're a little, it's less like you are building a deck around a giant endgame effect. And these are quests that they're much more flexible. You should be able to build them in a lot of different kinds of decks and maybe kind of get that reward in the mid game. And it's not necessarily just a game winning giant effect. So they occupy a different design space and that lets us play around. So we can bring back favorite mechanics, but in a different way.
Yeah, the word complementary keeps entering my head when I look at the new quests, at least the ones we've seen so far. You know, while we're on the subject too of Mean Streets and old stuff like that, did Wild come into play at all with the design of this card? You know, are you thinking about, you know, Taunt Warrior as it exists in Wild and what people are playing with in there?
A lot of the times we'll think about it. We won't necessarily play test it heavily, but I think this is actually going to be pretty cool for Wild, because now Taunt Warrior will get, you know, people will try it out again and they'll combine it. It happens whenever we revisit a theme, both like hand buff and taunt both get, like, people think about, oh, what does it look like in Wild, right? So that'll be really awesome. Questing Explorer, the 2-mana 2/3 draw card if you have a quest, will also see some play in Wild as people want to improve their Wild quest decks.
Do you expect Wild quest decks to have more than one quest? So maybe you start one quest at the beginning of the game and then another quest later on. Is that anything you guys have seen toyed around with internally?
It hasn't worked out. The themes are usually different, so you have to have a bunch of cards, say a bunch of Battlecry cards. Example for the Shaman one, Corrupt the Waters quest in Shaman. And if you're trying to do another quest at the same time, it's just like getting the synergies is tough.
Battle Crying Murlocs sounds perfect to me.
Yeah, maybe it's okay. There are a bunch of Battlecry Murlocs. The one that is relatively new that gives you a lackey is quite good in both decks.
Yeah.
So it could happen.
Yeah, for sure. I know what you're excited to make, Joss. There's no...
I know. You can just see the excitement on my face when I'm talking about Battle Crying Murlocs. That's day one deck Wild for sure.
Just to be clear for everyone watching, you can only have one quest in play at a time.
Right.
So yeah, like Jocelyn said, you have to finish one and then start the next one.
Yeah, you have to...
But I could do Battle Cries and then I could play more Murlocs later.
Yeah. Yeah, it's possible. So I'd love to see it.
Some of the other cards that kind of popped in my head when I saw this, again, because of cards that I know of at this time, like, you know, you mentioned Zilliax, and that was obviously like the first thing that I was like, oh, this is going to be great with Zilliax. But what about maybe some cards that haven't had as much spotlight up to this point, like Omega Defender, or even going deeper, like Unpowered Steambot or Amani Warbear? Anyone been trying to make those work with Armagedillo?
I think they're worth trying out. I think Omega Defender was already like almost good enough, so this will help it. There's two Taunt Lifesteal guys that you can try out to see how they go with some hand buffs, but they're like not great cards on their own. The thing that usually makes competitive decks is all the cards are really powerful on their own, and then on top of that also have synergies. That's why Zilliax is such a great example. Yeah. But people definitely experiment and try and figure out what the next best ones are.
So switching gears a little bit here, we're seeing Year of the Dragon kind of do something that we haven't seen in Hearthstone before, which is trying to tell a kind of overarching story. So we're now in chapter 2 of 3, if you will. Mm-hmm. How do you guys feel like storytelling in Hearthstone has played out? Are you happy with the direction and the reception from the community? Is everything working out how you thought it was going to?
The challenge for us that we kind of knew going into the year was, if you have the whole year is based on a theme, you want to make sure that if people don't like that theme, are they going to like skip out of a whole year? We don't want that. So we want to make sure that each sort of chapter feels very distinct and is new, kind of has a new environment and new things going on. So I think you can see that in Rise of Shadows and Saviors of Uldum. They feel very different, even though we are kind of telling a consistent story throughout. The other tricky part is, you know, we kind of want to foreshadow what's going to happen next, but you know, we don't want to give away the next set every time. And it's tough because our community, they'll catch every detail. They'll look at the, you know, this symbol matches the card back. And now we know the next expansion. So myself and the other, you know, everybody kind of pitches in on the writing in Hearthstone. I think we landed in a pretty good space where there's definitely a consistent story flowing throughout. But the next chapters are a surprise, but they're not completely unexpected. It helps to have a villain like Rafam, because Rafam has a master plan, but it's hard to see a few steps ahead in his master plan. So clearly he's up to something here. And because we're focused on the heroes this expansion, we don't actually see from his point of view. Like, we were the bad guys in the last set. This time, right, we don't know. What is he doing? Why is he unleashing these plagues? Like, what is his end game? What's he going to do next? We'll have to find out as the year concludes. But so far, the storytelling has been a lot of fun. And I think people are really engaged in what will happen next. And that's a success from our perspective.
Do you think that there's any danger? Because you talked about, you know, if some people don't like the overarching story, then you risk kind of alienating some of your audience. Then giving villain classes to 5 and then hero classes to the other 4, are you kind of worried about how that might feel? Like, if I'm a shaman player and I'm kind of just a villain for a year, was that a concern at all?
Do you feel like a villain for a year? Because I heard you master planning the double quest, Outcry Murlocs. It sounded super villainous to me, Josh. I don't know. Hopefully not. Hopefully the themes of the sets are just kind of standalone, just unique in and of themselves. And they're just really fun decks to build. You know, there's just a lot for players to kind of sink their teeth into, and I hope they really enjoy it.
Sticking with kind of the theming of each expansion, is this expansion single player going to follow in the footsteps of Heist? Are you allowed to speak to that? Or are we going to see something different? Curious if there's any parts of Heist that you thought maybe needed improving, or that we can expect to see be different in the new single player.
Yeah. So like we did with Rise of Shadows, we'll talk more about the upcoming single player kind of after the set releases, give people a chance to play with the collectible set and the multiplayer. And then we'll talk a lot more. I can tell you, it'll follow very much the same format as the Great Dalaran Heist. We'll be delving into all the secrets of Uldum in a very similar format. But we do have some new mechanics, or some changes to the mechanics to fit the theme of the Saviors of Uldum. So I'm really excited to talk about that. we'll wait a few weeks and start talking about that some more. But it should be a lot of fun.
I really enjoyed the kickoff for single player this year.
Excellent. Yeah.
Yeah. Heist was really, really fun.
our mission team is larger than ever, and we've really been pouring a lot of heart and soul into this content. Great response so far from the Dalaran Heist, which is really encouraging to us.
Now that the Explorers are coming back, I just want your super suave version of Medivh to come back. That's like the only thing, the only returning star I want to see.
He could be the infamous third faction, the League of Medivh. It's just him. It's he the could most totally exclusive be his
own league.
It's the most exclusive league. Like a red velvet rope around him.
That sounds like something he would do, actually.
I'm sorry, we've given away the third expansion.
Are we on brand?
Yeah. Well, speaking of leagues, just one last question here, kind of more on the esports side of things. We obviously this year saw a kind of new format coming out in Specialist, and the only other warrior card that we've seen so far is Restless Mummy, obviously with the new keyword Reborn, which seems like it would be a really great tech card, possibly even interchangeable with Militia Commander in Specialist. So do you design cards like that with a tech feel with Specialist in mind, or is this just Russian Reborn is just something you want to play around with?
We've actually always liked tech cards. This isn't directly related to Specialist, but it happens to also apply really well to Specialist. We made some cards, for example, that like Battle Cry, summon a 2-2 Griffin for your opponent, or Death Rattle, summon a 0/3, taunt for your opponent. And these cards are good because they can mess up like a priest res pool, for example. And that has an impact on wild, albeit a small one. but I think the idea behind those cards, the idea that you can play tech cards, you can go to your collection if you're worried about a specific match and add some cards in, is something that we really believe in. And we're going to continue doing that, maybe even do more of that as time goes forward.
The Reborn mechanics are a lot of fun. We can play with a lot of, there's a lot of design space there to play with. We revealed the Reborn Rush. Well, that's great because you kind of get two rushes in.
Right.
You do it right. Reborn Taunt is fun too. It's just very sticky. It's kind of hard to get rid of that. And then anybody.
My favorite's the Reborn Death Rattle ones.
Yeah.
I was going to say, yeah. So what about Death Rattle? What is
Death
that?
Death Rattle.
Thing? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's good stuff. Reborn has been a lot of fun for our design team to play around with.
Yeah, I'm really excited for Reborn. It was there was a lot of things in that first initial announcement that looked really solid. But for me, Reborn, I love res mechanics, and to see a new one that isn't tied to priest is super, yeah. Super cool. Great. I guess, again, this is coming out a little bit later, but congrats on the announcement and the reveal season so far. And
Thank you.
We really appreciate you taking time to stop by our podcast and our channel to talk about Armagedillo. So
this has been super fun. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks again, yes, both
thank
of you.
Very much.
We'd like to thank the Hearthstone team one more time for putting this interview together. And we'd like to thank you for watching. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to like and subscribe, and find the Angry Chicken Podcast wherever podcasts can be found.